calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us is given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens, so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro, and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth and building itself up in love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand if you are able for the reading of the Gospel. The Holy Gospel, according to St. John, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were beside the sea, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing?" "Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it was my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
God, that you would help me to share the words that I feel you've given me to share this morning. our hearts and our ears to receive from you today. In your name, amen. So, my wife and I, we have three children. We have one on the way in October. We're really excited. But when all of my kids were small, and they're still small, but when they were small, when we put them into bed, one of their favorite things to say was, "Tell me a story. Tell me a story." On my feet, I just never really felt like I was really that good of a storyteller, and I said, "Let me get your mom, she'll tell you a story." But as I was working in the schools last year, one of my lessons was to talk about what a story was with the students, what a book was. And so we talked about how a story has a setting, and a story has characters, and a story has action. And even going back to when my kids would say, "Tell me a story," they'd say, "Tell me a story about such and such." My daughter would say, "Tell me a story about a princess. Tell me a story about this. Tell me a story about that. Tell me a story that has me in it. Tell me a story. Tell me a story." And so this morning, I want to talk about a few stories from the Bible. And most of us probably have a Bible. It's a collection of books, 66 books to be exact, 39 in the Old Testament, 27 in the New Testament. And it's a collection of stories. But I want to present to you this morning that it's not just a collection of stories. It's one whole story from beginning to end. It's one continual story about God's love for his creation, about God's redemptive plan for his people. It starts with creation and goes all the way into the future. It's this continual story that we are still living, that we are still involved with. So if you will, look at the story of Lazarus being raised from the dead. And I'm going to read it from John's Gospel. Verse 38 says, "Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. 'Take away the stone,' he said. 'But Lord,' said Martha, the sister of the dead man, 'by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been in there for 4 days.' Then Jesus said, 'Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?' So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, 'Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me.' When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, 'Lazarus, come out!' The dead man came out of his hand, came out with his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, 'Take off the grave clothes and let him go.'" So, when we think about stories from the Bible, one thing that I think we need to remember is all of the characters, all of the people involved in the story were real people. They're not just characters in a story, but they're real people that were involved in the story. Now, I want to focus on one thing that Jesus said in this story. What a great miracle it was to raise Lazarus from the dead. But I want to go back to the beginning, where he said, "Take away the stone." Now, Jesus is about to raise Lazarus from the dead, right? That's pretty miraculous, I would say. So I'm not sure that he really needs help moving this stone. But he said, take away the stone. Now, we're not quite sure, does it say who took away the stone? A lot of scholars think the disciples were part of that and took away the stone. But finally, the stone was removed. And then Jesus has this prayer, and he says that he doesn't say these things for his benefit, but for the people that are standing around him. Okay? So these 2 points, that Jesus had someone help remove the stone, and he said some of the things that he said for the benefit of those that were all around him. Why did he do these things? I think maybe when I look at it and I just think, I think maybe he wanted them involved in the story. He wanted them to be a part of what he was doing. He said, remove the stone, and they were a part of removing the stone. They were part of the miracle. He said those things for the benefit of the people around him. He said them for them to understand what was going on in the story. There's another story where Jesus feeds the 5,000. Sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, and a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he had performed by healing the sick. Then Jesus went up on the mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover festival was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than a half year's wage to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite." Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here's a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. And he did the same with the fish. When they had gathered all of the pieces, and everyone had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "They gathered them and filled the 12 baskets with pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten." Now in this story, I have to admit, I copied and pasted from the wrong gospel. But in the story, we know that Jesus got the bread and the fish from a boy who had this lunch with him. And they brought the boy to Jesus, and Jesus took the bread and he multiplied it. Now, when I think about this story, Jesus could have created the bread, the fish, whatever they wanted, just because he's Jesus. He didn't need the bread and the fish to multiply. I mean, we even read scriptures where birds would come with the manna and give manna. But Jesus had a plan. God had a plan to involve a little boy in providing for the miracle. And I think that we can see these 2 stories. We can see that God wants us to be actively involved in his story. Yes, it's his story, but he wants us to be involved in it. He wants us to actually participate in what he's doing. I don't think he wants us just sitting on the sidelines, just waiting to go to heaven. I think he wants us involved in what he's doing. See, when Jesus left, after he had risen from the dead, he walked the earth, and then he left his disciples. He gave the Great Commission, right? This is a call to be involved in what God is doing. Matthew 28:19, "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. That's a call to be involved in what he's doing, what God is doing. Another call to be involved in what God is doing is found in John 13, verses 34 through 35. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. He calls us to love. He calls us to love each other. He calls us to love our neighbors. He calls us to love our enemies. He calls us to love. And this call to love, I believe, spurs the heart of service to our fellow man. And that's being a part of God's story. That's being a part of what God is doing. We are that extension here on earth to maybe those who don't know him, or maybe those who need something. We can provide service. We can provide help. We can reach out and be his hands and be his feet on this earth because we are a part of his wonderful story. Now, let me be honest with you. I am not that athletic. But I do like to have fun and play sports, right? I played sports growing up. Wasn't that really that good, but it was fun to be on the team. It was fun to be involved. Anybody watching the Olympics? Anybody like the Olympics? Some of you, yes. Okay. I was thinking about the Olympics, and I was thinking about how much pride Olympians must feel when they compete, when they work so hard, and they go out and they compete. They're, you know, maybe they're on the U.S. Olympic team, maybe it's the maybe they swim, maybe they run, maybe they're on the soccer team, but they're a part of the team. And how much pride they must feel when they're involved and they're competing and they work so hard to get there and they finally made it to that moment. And I just sit and watch and I know, oh gosh, it's got to be so much fun to be there. Do that and compete. Right? I think God's saying to us, get out of the stands. Quit just sitting by and watching. Get out of the stands and get involved in my story. Get on the team and get out here. Get out here and serve. Get out here and love one another. Be a part of the story. The story isn't over. Yeah, we have the Bible, but it's just a continuation. We're in the middle of it. And I believe that God's calling us to get out and to get on the team and to get involved. Whatever that looks like for you. God can use anything that you have to fulfill whatever purpose he's given you. He can use your time, he can use your talent, he can use your treasure, he can use all of those things to help further the gospel, to help serve one another, to help make his name known. Whatever it is, get out of the stands and get into the game. You sing a song here in the second service called I Refuse. And as I was thinking about how we should get active into the story that God has, get active into what he's doing, and not just sitting back and waiting, but being a part of the story, being a part of what he's doing. The chorus says, because I don't want to live like I don't care. I don't want to say another empty prayer. Oh, I refuse to sit around and wait for someone else to do what God has called me to do myself. Oh, I can choose not to move, but I refuse. Be a part of God's story. Play your part. Do your thing, whatever that is. But do what he's calling you to do and be a part God, I thank you that you've called us to be a part of your story, that you've called us to be active members of the team, to serve, to share the story of your love, to love one another, to build your kingdom. I pray, God, that you would help us to get up and move with you and to serve in the areas that you have called us to serve in. God, I pray if we don't have any area on our mind or we don't know what that might look like, I pray, God, that you would put something in our heart that we could get involved with, that we could serve, be a part of, if it's just here in the church or whatever that looks like, God. But I pray that you would give us all a passion for something so that we can just be a part of the story and serve you, God. I thank you, Lord, for the honor and privilege it is to work for you and to share your love with this world.